Ayan, magandang umaga po sa inyong lahat and welcome to our second service, 11 a.m. service. And dalawang buwan na lang halos, no? Tapos na yung taon, 2020. And we are still at the peak of the fight against this virus. And meron ako nakausap na pastor na yung laban natin ay magpapatuloy pa hanggang next year, no? Pero again, dapat daw marunong tayo mag-thrive. Ang church daw dapat mag-thrive sa lahat ng pagkakataon, sa lahat ng sitwasyon dito sa meron tayo. Kailangan daw ang church ay may palaging may advantage in every circumstance and situations along the way. True enough, kasi pag tinignan mo yung Bible, even in the midst of opposition, persecution, yung church ni Lord nagkukontinyo mag-thrive. And if you look at the scripture, no, yung even in the midst of severe trial and the persecution, yung people of God continually speak about God's word and the gospel. And so that is a testament that indeed that in every situation, whether it is hard or it is quite easy, the church of God, the people of God will continue to thrive and to speak about the grace and the love of God towards people. All right, just to go back to our series Gospel Express, no, in our week 19 last week, we talk about love in action. And our tinignan natin yung Romans chapter 12 verse 9 to 21, wherein our main point is that we can demonstrate the gospel when we sincerely and tangibly show love to everyone. And so it I think Pastor Daniel and Pastor JC speak about this the love that is showered on God's people, that in turn they will show it up for other people so that they will know also God. Now week 20 we will be looking at Christian duties, okay, mga duties natin, and as a Christian, and we look at Romans 13, verse 1 to 14. Now, if we look at, just to give you a quick recap, alam natin, no, when Paul wrote the book of Romans, from Romans chapter 1 to chapter 16, yung first 11 chapters, Paul devoted it to explain about the gospel. Now, chapter 12 make a big shift from presenting what the gospel is to translating it to our personal lives. So from verse 12, from chapter 12 up to chapter 16, Paul laid down a very clear picture of the effect of the gospel towards us. At yung isang effect na yon ay pinag-usapan natin last week, that we should be dealing with other people with the love of God. And so with that, jump into our word, and just to make it simpler, I just want to read verse 1 of Romans chapter 13, and then afterwards we will go through verse by verse in chapter 13 until verse 14. All right, so let me read to you verse 1. Let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authorities except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. Let me pray. Lord, thank you as we jump into, again, to listen to you, listen to your word, to understand about the implications of the gospel towards our individual lives. Thank you, Lord, for the grace that you showered on us. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to receive your word and believe your word, and Lord, to mature in you and grow spiritually. Thank you, Lord, for using each one of us in many ways in spreading the good news of the kingdom of God. Thank you, Lord, for keeping us even in the midst of circumstances. And Lord, thank you that you are really involved in our lives, in our daily lives. Thank you, Lord, for your people, for keeping them and for blessing them. We look to you now for grace and instructions. Thank you, Lord. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Now, Paul made, while God calls us to his heavenly values, people thought that the world is something that is so unclean. And so people would think that God, we needed to, as people of God, abandon the world. But we need to realize that God did not abandon the world. God was renewing the world. And part of that process and agents of change in this world is us. And there are institutions that God placed in the world that we need to be part of and that we need to submit ourselves with it. You know that when we look at us and we understand the gospel and the implications about it in the way that we relate to other people in our families, in our neighbors, in the people in general. And not only that, but the institutions that God set or instituted or ordained to be over us. And that those are the things that we need to know when it comes to relating with them, so that ultimately it will have an impact. It will have an influence. We can have an influence towards these institutions in a way that will please God, in a way that we will declare the purposes of God. And so today we will be looking at an institution that God instituted or ordained and God placed that we need to submit to, and that is the governing authorities or the government that we have. And also the way we should relate towards our neighbors. So titingnan natin yun as we progress in the text that we have read in Romans chapter 13. But before that, I had an opportunity to sit with a general, a police general, many years ago. Sa ngayon, retired na siya. And we were talking, and you know, yung mga kabataan tayo, di ba? Yung mga police, yung mga, when we were young, yung ating mga parents, parang ayaw nila tayong lumapit sa, parang takot, no? Merong instilled fear when we look at policemen or weak people in authority. And so parang ayaw, we shy away from that. And I don't know kung saan galing yon. And maybe yung people had different experiences when relating to our authorities, to the police in particular. And that's why they have different views concerning authorities. And of course, not just the police, but authorities or the government in general. But I had that chance, and he was explaining to me the purpose of police. And that is to protect us. In fact, sabi niya, may mga tao nagsisimula ang criminality kapag ka ikaw ay merong motive. So, nang una motive, tapos gagamit ka ng instrumentality. Para, this is something that he explained so that crime will be consummated. Okay? Kailangan itong tatlong elements na to ay present so that a crime will be consummated. So, motive, merong instrumentality, at opportunity. Yun yung motive, wala daw silang magagawa doon. Ang may trabaho daw noon yung mga simbahan, no? Tayo, yung mga motibo ng mga tao, kailangan base doon sa ating pagtuturo ng salita ng Panginoon at being an example towards them. So, sabi nila, wala kaming masyadong magawa doon. Okay? Eh, yung instrumentality, present yan everywhere. So, what we are preventing actually is yung opportunity to do the crime. So, pag wala yung opportunity, hindi mako-consummate yung crime. So, he was explaining it to me that way. Na, in a sense, I captured the idea that really they are there for our protection. Now, let's jump into our text in verse 1. Let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. Verse 2, therefore, whoever resist the authorities, resist what God has appointed. And those who resist will incur judgment. For rulers are not a terror to God, to good conduct, but to bad. Would you have no fear of the one who is in authority? Then do what is good, and you will receive his approval. Verse 4, for he is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain. For he is the servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. Now, the first thing that we can glean on this is the idea that we have legal duties. Okay? Legal duties. Now, submit to governing authorities. We can't submit to civil authorities if you are not submitted to the Lordship of Christ. So it will be something that is difficult. But human government is ordained by God. Ideally, government are organized for our welfare. It is for our advantage, for the people of God, that government are in place. Take, for example, the criminals in prison. Diba, marami tayong mga jails. City jail, mga sa Muntinlupa, and then yung pinakamalalaking jail. And you know that it is for our own good. Could you imagine if there's no government and the criminals are roaming around the streets? Kasi nga, hindi naman sila kinokollect, no? Hindi sila inuhuli because of their wrongdoings. It will be chaotic. And that's why the government works for our advantage. It is for our own welfare. And that is the reason why God instituted it. And you know, the principle that God is trying to let us know here is that part of our spiritual worship, when Paul make a shift in verse 12, that in view of God's mercy, let us offer our bodies as living sacrifices. And so part of our sacrificial worship or spiritual act of worship is to be submitted to the governing authorities. And this is for two reasons. One, to be a good witness for Christ. We should be the most loyal, the most faithful, the most obedient citizen, or the best citizens of any nation. Christians should be the best citizens of their nation, because we carry with us Christ, and we are ambassadors of Christ. And so that nation isn't doing well, we should be the best citizens of that nation. Una, to be a good witness. Pangalawa, to obey authority, or submitting to authorities. You know why? Because ultimately, all authorities under earth or in earth, all authorities, the ultimate head of that is Christ. When you look at families, we know that the head of the family is the husband. But ultimately, the head of the husband is Christ himself. If you look at church, we know that the one governing the church are pastors and leaders. And yet, at the top of pastors is also Christ himself. And so we, in the same token, in the government, we know that the head of the government is the president, but at the top of the president is God himself. And so we submit ourselves to the governing authorities because of our obedience towards God ultimately. Now we are just, if you look at this command of God, command wherein Paul wrote that we should submit ourselves to the governing authorities. It doesn't mean that in every way we will do what the government tells us. There are exceptions that we could see in the entire Bible concerning submission to governing authorities. Meron mga exemptions. Hindi siya absolute. And we will see that we could resist or even resist or not follow the government if they will teach us how to be idolaters, or even if the government will do evil against us. In other words, they will not function in the way that the scripture calls them. In verse 2 and verse 3 and verse 4, it is very clear that God created or instituted the government to our welfare and our protection. If the flip side is happening, then are we going to follow the government? So sa Bible, may makikita tayong mga reasons. At yung unang reason is, one, why would someone resist a governing authority? Number one, to save innocent lives. To save innocent lives. Makikita natin dito in the account of Zipporah and Orpah, okay? Si Zipporah and Puah. In Exodus chapter 1, verse 15 to 17, during the time that the Pharaoh ordered these midwives to kill every boy born. So sinabihan niya yung mga midwives na pagkalalaki sa Israel, kasi nakita ni nung Pharaoh, dumadami na yung mga Israelites. At feeling niya, threat na yung mga Israelites doon sa mga Egyptians. Sa pagkadumami sila ng dumami, ma-overpower sila ng mga Egyptians, ng mga Israelites, itong mga Egyptians. And so sabi ng Pharaoh, pagka sinabi niya doon sa mga midwives na Israelites, pagka lalaki, patayin niyo, itapon niyo sa Nile River. Kapag kababae, pabayaan niyo lang mabuhay. And so ang ginawa ni Puah and Zipporah, hindi nila sinunod yung Pharaoh, si Zipporah. But rather, they allow the boys to live. Diba? Isa nga doon ay si Moses. And you see that they came against or resist what the governing authorities called them to do. And if you read further in Exodus chapter 1, you will see that God commended these midwives and blessed them even. And so, it's a clear picture of coming against the governing authorities, and yet it is something that it is the right thing to do. The other one is to practice real worship to God and avoid idolatry. So if the reason or the motive of resisting the government is to avoid idolatry and to practice real worship, then you are justified for doing so. Remember the account of Daniel in the book of Daniel chapter 3, wherein Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego would not bow down to an idol. And even Daniel 6, wherein Daniel himself would pray to God 3 times a day because they were being forbidden to pray to any god except the king. And so Daniel did not do that. He continued to worship God and to pray to God. And so this is a clear picture of not following an edict or a decree or even a law that the governing institutions are giving because of avoiding idolatry and having a true worship towards God. Another reason is to preach the gospel. If you look at the account of Peter and the apostles, they were being forbidden by the governing authorities to preach the gospel. But Peter says that I will follow God more than men. You see that there are exceptions to this rule or command that Paul espoused in Romans chapter 13. But again, the motivation should be to save innocent lives, to avoid idolatry, and to preach the gospel. If you look at us as a church, we know that we have missionaries. We are a missionary sending church. We send missionaries to restricted access nations where Christians are not supposed to preach the gospel. Pero di ba, tinutulungan pa natin sila, meron silang underground church. And so we are doing that in effect, in a way, in the viewpoint, to the viewpoint of the authorities in that nation, we are coming against them, di ba? But in the viewpoint of God, we are doing the right thing because we are spreading the gospel. So when do we resist? When the ruling authorities starts doing evil instead of good, when the authorities no longer do their purpose as expressed in the scripture. Now moving on in verse 8, it says, owe no one anything except to love each other, for the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. For the commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandments are summed up in this word, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Verse 10, love does not wrong to a neighbor, does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. The second thing, the second duty that we have is the love duties. Okay? Yung una, legal duties, meron tayo niyan. At meron din tayong love duties. Now, love your neighbor as yourself. Why does love sum all the commandments? Pag-inisip mo, oh, ano, bakit yung love sum up the commandments? Because love does not harm to its, does no harm to its neighbors. Because love does no harm to its neighbor. If you look at the five forbidden, the last five forbidden commandments in the Ten Commandments, murder, it robs our neighbors with their life. If you look at adultery, of their home and honor. If theft, you rob them of their property. If false witness, you rob them of good name. If covetousness, you rob society of the ideas of simplicity and contentment. That is why loving your neighbor as yourself is the summary of all the commandments. All these do harm to yung mga commandments the Lord that people are breaking. All of these are harming, okay, or detrimental to our neighbors. And yet we know that if we truly love our neighbors, then murdering them, stealing from them, committing adultery with them or their spouses, and so are unthinkable. We will not think such a thing because we have an outstanding love towards our neighbors. It will be difficult to love our neighbors if we are not under the lordship of Jesus. Without experiencing the love of God, it will be difficult to love our neighbors. Loving others is done in gratitude for the great love Christ has shown us. It involves loving our enemies. As Jesus has reminded us, we must go beyond the outward act and deal with the inner attitude. We should not only refuse to murder people, but also cease to be angry with them. We need to put out love towards and from us towards others. As an illustration, one of the greatest learnings that I have for being a minister. Siguro, I'm a pastor for 15 years. But I came to the Lord when I was first year college, at the age of 17. And so, mahaba-haba na rin yung journey ko, no, with God. And so marami po akong learnings and marami akong realizations in my personal life. Pero one of the greatest, ito, pinakamatindi na naintindihan ko, is that it, being angry with others has no place in the ministry. Anger has no place in the ministry. Because when you are angry, you will not show love towards them. Iba, you will encounter people in your lives that will show your love the most to those people who are really unlovable. Sa lahat ng lugar, sa lahat ng arena, merong pinapadala si Lord na very challenging people. Meron tayong isang pastor, ang tawag niya doon, mga EGN. Alam niyo yung mga EGN? Yung mga extra grace needed. Okay? Extra grace needed. And so, sa church, pag meron yan, isa lang ang katapat niyan. Hindi galit. Okay? Hindi ang response natin ay angry or anger. Hindi. Ang katapat lang yan, discipleship. And so, you will show them God's love by allowing them to learn more about God in discipleship. Now, if you treat them that way, you love them, you try to give them God's word, you try to disciple them, for them to know, to love God more. And then at the end of it, sa dulo nun, walang nangyari. I think it's up to them. But we don't need to be angry with other people. That is an illustration that indeed we are called to love, and we are called to love people who are even unlovable. Moving on, in verse 11, besides this, you know the time, that the hour has come for you to wake from sleep. For salvation is nearer to us now than we first believed. Verse 12, the night is far gone, the day is at hand. So then let us cast off the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us walk properly as in the daytime, not in orgies and drunkenness, not in sexual immorality and sensuality, not in quarreling and jealousy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. Now, the last duty is the lordship duties. Put on Christ and put off the works of darkness. Now, to put on the Lord Jesus Christ carries the idea of making Jesus a part of everything you say and do. So, when you talk about putting Jesus Christ on you, you can have that picture of Jesus being your dress, okay? Parang cloth, parang ito, parang damit na sinuot mo. At kung saan ka man pumunta, dala-dala mo si Jesus. Kapag ka ikaw ay magdi-decide, when you are making decisions, then Jesus is part of your decision. When you are a single and you are living a single life, then you know that Jesus is with you. When it comes to your marriage relationship, then Jesus is part of your marriage relationship. When you watch or hear anything, you know that Jesus is part of you. And that is what Paul was saying when he said to put on Christ in you. You have a sense and understanding that Jesus is with you and he is actually clothing you with his love and with his grace and mercy and with his joy and peace. Wherever you go, Christ is in you. And so, by your way you live, by the way you live, you reveal that either He is Lord of all or He is not Lord at all. By the way we conduct ourselves, then people will show whether we are clothed by Jesus Christ Himself. The gospel should affect the way you relate to your spouse. It should affect the way you relate to your husband, to your wife. It will affect the way you relate to your siblings, to your children, to yung tindera dun sa may palengke, okay? Yung kapitbahay mo, yung katabi mo, it should affect yung naggumugupit sa iyo, yung barberong gumugupit. It should affect the way you relate towards everyone, because Christ, you clothe yourself with Christ. This is now, in conclusion, as people of God, we have legal duties to submit ourselves to the governing authorities. We have love duties. We have an outstanding debt or utang to everyone. And that is the loving, and that is loving them. Utang natin yun, na mahalin ang lahat ng tao sa paligid natin. And then lastly, Lord, love duties, Lordship duties, wherein we clothe God wherever we go. God is part of our lives. This is my one point as I end. We are obligated to submit to governing authorities and to fulfill the law by loving our neighbors. Let us pray. Lord, thank you as we, Lord, know the application of the gospel and the implication of the gospel to us. I pray that you will inject on your people the love towards our neighbors, the people around us, not only to our loved ones, to our friends, but even to those who are unlovable, even if we have enemies, even to our enemies. I pray, Lord, that you will, Lord, grab a hold of our mind and our hearts, that we will, Lord, represent you well towards other people. And I know, Lord, that this is a testimony of your greatness, the greatness of your love towards us, that while we were still sinners, you died for us. That's the kind of love that you have shown to us. And I pray that it will also reflect in our lives. I pray that we'll be submissive to the governing authorities, even to authorities that you place in our lives. I pray that we will obey and submit, because ultimately, we are submitting to your Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your people, those who are listening right now. I pray that you will touch them, you will bless them, and you will provide for their needs. Thank you, God. Bless all the families, Lord God, represented in our church and in the church around the world. This I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.